Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Speaking about the role of cultural diplomacy and culture in diplomacy, I would like to start with some points of departure. Number one, conventional diplomacy is based on hard power, on military and economic potentials of the countries concerned. Cultural diplomacy is based on soft power, on values. Cultural diplomacy is based on the cultural heritage and on the current present-day cultural potentials of the countries. Point number two. Conventional diplomacy covers mostly political and economic relations. It is aimed at improving the international environment, creating better political and economic conditions for the country concerned. It results in treaties and agreements that set mutually beneficial rules for bilateral and multilateral cooperation. The most important goal of conventional diplomacy is to prevent or manage and settle interstate conflicts, and guarantee peace, international security, and stability on the long run. The goal of cultural diplomacy is to bring the people of different countries closer to each other, to promote dialogue and understanding between them. Point number three, the field of cooperation, the field of operation and of conventional diplomacy is the network of bilateral and multilateral relations between states. The actors are the states, the political leaders, and the political parties. The actors of cultural diplomacy are the prominent personalities of culture, including arts, education, and science, writers, poets, composers, musicians, professors, scientists, institutions, NGOs, the organized and non-organized civil society, in one word, the people. Point number four, the impact of hard power is certainly faster, but less stable, as it depends on the changing military and economic potentials, which can result even in new conflicts. The impact of soft power is much slower, but much more long-lasting and free of conflict of interest. So these are the differences and the identity of hard power and soft power, the conventional and cultural diplomacy. Looking back into history, during the decades of bipolar world order and the Cold War between the US and the Soviet Union, between the two blocs, based on their own and specific shared values, multi-party democracy, the rule of law, and market economy in the Western democracies, facing one-party authoritarian regimes and command economy in the Soviet bloc. The Euro-Atlantic community established NATO for common defense and the institution of step-by-step economic and political integration, while the Soviet bloc countries built the Warsaw Pact and the Comecon. Conventional diplomacy played an instrumental role in the prevention of military conflicts between the two opposing blocs, though regional wars in the Korean Peninsula, in the Caribbean region, in Indochina, in the Middle East and elsewhere seriously endangered peace even on the world scale. Conventional diplomacy later promoted détente in the 70s, which resulted in the Helsinki summit in 1975. The Helsinki Final Act set the rules of peaceful coexistence between the Western democracies and the Soviet bloc countries. The first basket of the Helsinki Final Act guaranteed the borders in Europe. The second one opened the way for some limited economic cooperation, while the third basket cautiously opened the door for a few centimeters for the free exchanges of people and ideas. After the Helsinki summit, conventional and cultural diplomacy started to work more closely together, mutually reinforcing the impact of each other. Conventional diplomacy established the political framework, the possibilities and the limits, while cultural diplomacy provided the human content. Hungary was the first Soviet bloc country that hosted a post-Helsinki event, a forum of cultural diplomacy, the Budapest Cultural Forum, in the late 70s. The lively debates reflected the major differences between the position of Western democracies and the Soviet bloc countries. But it clearly showed the importance of cultural diplomacy. The event encouraged some prominent intellectuals who belonged to the democratic opposition in Hungary to the Soviet-type authoritarian one-party system to organize a parallel forum in order to speak in favor of democratic changes in Hungary. The basic instrument of conventional diplomacy carries and serves the implementation of political strategies and interests. Consequently, during the Cold War, it had not any real influence on the ordinary people, on the public. It did not bring people on the two sides of the Iron Curtain closer to each other. But the Helsinki Final Act, and particularly its third basket, opened the way for cultural diplomacy. Cultural diplomacy has soft instruments that carry values. The values of Western democracies penetrated even through the Iron Curtain and weakened the isolation between East and West in Europe. In the late 70s and in the 80s, the democratic values showed an alternative for the monolithic societies in the Soviet bloc countries and encouraged step-by-step economic and political reforms. Cultural exchanges and papers, books, film, music coming from the Western countries had also an indirect but basically positive impact on the people in Central and Eastern Europe. Hungary in the early 80s had already regular high-level visits from and to Western democracies in Europe and even in North America. In 1984, the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, Italy, Belgium, Sweden, and Helmut Kohl, the Chancellor of the Federal Republic of Germany, visited Budapest. In the second half of the 80s, these visits were followed by the Queen of the Netherlands and Denmark, the King of Spain, the President of the Federal Republic of Germany, and even US President George Bush. The Hungarian Prime Minister, in the same time, visited Austria, Greece, the Federal Republic of Germany, the US, and Canada. With these top-level official visits, with the re-establishment of diplomatic relations between Hungary and Israel, later between Hungary and the Vatican, with the newly established diplomatic relations between Hungary and the Republic of Korea and South Africa, Hungary was unique in the Soviet bloc. This wide range of opening towards the Western democracies was crowned by the decision of the Hungarian government to open the Austro-Hungarian border, which led more than 60,000 refugees from East Germany to come to the Federal Republic. The opening of the border was soon followed by the collapse of the Berlin Wall, the reunification of the two German states. Together with the political and economic transition in the Soviet bloc, the disintegration of the Soviet Union, the end of the Warsaw Pact and Comecon, it resulted in a major step towards the unification of Europe, this widening of the European integration from 15 to 28 members today. During the Cold War period and the years of détente, cultural diplomacy was either the backdoor or the forerunner to promote interstate relations between the countries of the two blocs. Since 1990, after the political and economic transition in Central and Eastern Europe, cultural diplomacy has harmoniously fit into the wide range of instruments of interstate relations. The promotion of cultural exchanges is an effective way of marketing, involving the image of the country concerned. What is equally important, it can involve prominent persons of culture and large group of people into interstate relations and cooperation, which brings different countries really closer to each other. Cultural diplomacy as a soft instrument is of particular importance for smaller countries that have limited military and economic potentials. Hungarian culture has some oriental roots in the East, but more than 1,000 years it has become organic part of European culture in the same time. In order to boost cultural diplomacy, Hungary started to establish a network of cultural institute, the Collegium Hungaricum, as early as after the First World War. After the Second World War, cultural institutes were established on mutual basis in the capitals of the Soviet bloc countries, and in the 60s, Hungarian cultural institutes were opened in Cairo and even in New Delhi. after the political and economic transition, the cultural diplomacy received certainly more and more important role, consequently more attention from the Hungarian government. In the 90s, cultural center was opened in New York and London. After 2006, Hungary established a large network of cultural diplomats in the embassies, among others in Belgrade, Zagreb, Madrid, Beijing, Shanghai, Tel Aviv, and Abu Dhabi. Today, 28 countries of Europe are closely integrated in the European Union. One of the most important missions of the European Union is to increase its global role. The Common Foreign Security and Defense Policy is working hard on it. Parallel to it, cultural diplomacy can and should contribute to the enrichment of European identity, which is based on unity in variety. This Europe identity, European identity, makes EU even stronger. And cultural diplomacy should promote understanding between Europe and other continents, which is a sine qua non condition of peace, security, stability, democracy, and sustainable development on global stage. To conclude, I want to emphasize that in the era of globalization, conventional and cultural diplomacy finally have reached equal importance. They should go hand in hand. Their role is complementary. Their relation is permanent, but with continuous change, like the concept of yin and yang. At the end, I want to congratulate warmly the ICD, the Institute of Cultural Diplomacy, for its successful work and in promoting not only cultural diplomacy, but also in the cooperation and better relation between the hard and the soft power. Thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you very much for the possibility to speak here in this important gathering. And thank you for your attention.